I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter. Peanut butter. I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter. Peanut butter. I like peanut butter.
You're listening to the CheapGeek Podcast. Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/CheapGeek. So, welcome back to the CheapGeek Podcast. This is episode number 76.
New Gmail, Barbie, Amazon Prime, and you smell like fish.
Yeah. And welcome back to the CheapGeek Podcast. So here we go, and we're going to talk about all sorts of wonderful things this time. This time we're going to talk about Gmail, Barbie, Amazon Prime, and smell like fish.
Ew.
Yeah, good stuff, right?
Yeah.
So it begins again, and if you're listening to us on iTunes and Google Play Music and iHeartRadio and SoundCloud and all those other wonderful places, thank you very much. Do appreciate you tuning in. And this is the free version of our podcast because we're going to... We're making some big changes, making some big plans, things we're going to do. And honestly, in some ways, I feel sort of limited in what we can do with this podcast because we don't want to say anything bad or get in trouble, right?
Yeah.
Especially with everything going down with advertiser-friendly and all that stuff that showed up from YouTube. And are you touching? What are you doing?
I can't hear
you. Are you touching? Well, there you go. Say something now.
I'm talking
now. There you go. So anyway, we decided that... Yeah, we're going to make some things happen. And maybe find a different platform for a more adult podcast where you can still jump in, except you'll be able to have better interaction. If you got a webcam, you can fire it up and join us. You can be able to call in if you want. You can actually talk to us. It's going to be pretty spiffy.
We can say half the words printed on my rocks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's coming for the future. So yeah. And that'll be...
upcoming.
Yeah, in the future. How about that?
Yeah.
When? Not exactly sure. Maybe in the next week or two. We haven't worked out all the details yet because we got jobs.
Yeah.
Yeah. We worked a 9-to-5.
And more.
Sometimes more, sometimes less. So that's kind of where it is. So this podcast is going to be kind of fun because we're going to talk about some things sort of randomly thrown together. So this is our miscellaneous BS podcast, I think.
Yes.
For episode number 76.
An offbeat news podcast where we explore the strange, the stupid, and paranormal topics circulating the web.
Paranormal.
Yeah.
Spooky.
So.
Very nice.
And just a reminder, everybody can call the show. You can give us a call at 575-208-4025.
Yeah.
You can call in live. Or you can call anytime and leave a message, and we might just play that message on the show.
That's true.
Yes.
Or we might not.
True.
So it kind of begins.
Yeah.
Again. So.
Yeah. A little reminder, we do have that contest going on.
Why don't you refresh everybody's memories about the old contest so we can hurry up and give this Amazon Echo Dot thing away and get it off our...
desk.
Studio table thing.
So the contest, we actually threw a wrench into things. You needed to share our page or our podcast episode. With the new Facebook algorithm, we ended up having to merge two pages in one. We had to merge the Cheap Geek and the Cheap Geek podcast page.
Yes.
Into one. Don't freak out, Brian. All your little contributions still count. And each share equals a vote or an entry into the contest. Sorry. You can share the podcast episode post, or you can share the actual page to your own timeline, your own social media. When you do that, you get entered in. At the end of the contest, we run a little random generator thing, and we'll pick a name out as the winner for the Amazon Echo. There's going to be multiple chances to win. The primary prize, or the grand prize, is the Echo, but you'll have options like the full-size CheapGeek sticker, the new mini stickers that we have, patches, and possibly something from the Ordinary Hiker store on Facebook. So just keep sharing the posts. Brian did bring up a good question, though, about how do his posts count? Like, how am I going to be able to see them? If you are sharing publicly to your timeline, I will see the post. So for Brian, I think I only have a couple. If I'm wrong, then it might be because he's private or he shared it in a way that's not visible to me. Share it publicly. That we want more exposure. Yeah.
Making it sound desperate.
No. The whole point is to engage future potential listeners.
Engage.
You know what?
What?
I have Facebook
training. Those are buzzwords, man.
I have Facebook training next week. Facebook's actually hosting a community training event in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And I have to start using keywords and buzzwords like that. Like engagement and retention and stuff. So I don't know. When it comes to applying it to the podcast, I have to use like big business words. So yeah.
Jargon.
Jargon.
Get to be a jargonaut.
Yeah.
So, you know, acluistically speaking.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That was one of them.
Oh, I didn't even know that. Yeah. Oh, and we do have runner-up prizes, which also include the CheapGeek sticker and a mini sticker. We're also holding random polls in the Facebook CheapGeek group. Winners will pick random people out of there for a free sticker as well. All you have to do is interact with the page and with our podcast.
Nice.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if you can actually win an entire box of adult word rocks.
Oh, Dirk. What?
But you might be able to get a little something.
Really?
Yeah. In the old chat.
Oh, hi, David Larry. He's like in one of the hiking groups I'm in. Huh. So yes.
Not Larry David?
I know. Well, that's the ongoing joke.
Very yes. Nice.
So.
Anyway. Cool.
What? Oh, Brian, I apologize for calling you out. I just know you are very actively engaged in this contest. And we
engaged.
We totally appreciate it. And you do already get a mini sticker. So,
you know what Brian was saying?
What?
Total bullshit.
Yeah. See, you probably can't even do that on Facebook, really. I don't know. Maybe we can. We'll see. We just did it. Yeah.
Hmm. Okay.
Very nice.
All right. So.
Well, good. I'm glad we got the contest stuff all sort of squared away, figured out, and questions that were answered. Did anybody even have those questions, or are you just clarifying?
I think a couple of people had some questions, like, how am I going to see the posts?
You're like, hello.
And again, that goes back to that Facebook training I get to attend next week. Facebook is making engagements more about your person-to-person shares and posts. So they are making less stuff visible. So when you share the podcast page thing, you can always, you know, let me know afterward that you shared it and I'll go check it. That counts as an entry in the contest.
Very nice.
Or don't.
So I'm getting some hate mail.
Really?
Yes.
Like?
Let me see. I got some hate mail from a comment on our YouTube channel. It says, we don't like these long vlogs. Just get back to the snappy Russian hacker type crap and we'll be watching. Wake up and smell the Yorkshire tea, apple cider vinegar, and your hyper wife.
What?
I'm gonna give that a heart. I like your comment. And then now I have to reply.
Really?
Yeah. And it's gonna be a nice one. It's gonna say, you don't tell me what to do.
Great.
Yeah. Wait, I'll make it better. Thumbs up. Smiley faces with sunglasses. There we go.
So maybe we should keep the podcast on Facebook because I don't understand what apple cider vinegar.
Well, okay, so we actually we do the No, Hyper Wife.
Oh, Hyper Wife. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so we do the podcast here. We do it, you know, there's an audio version. If you're listening in the audio version right now, just to be aware, we've been doing some live streaming here and there. So, yeah, so some people really like because I have a YouTube channel, and some people really like the other videos that we did or that I do, and also a shorter podcast. So, I don't know. Can't make everybody happy is really what it boils down to. So, oh, this dude's still posting, so I will heart his little comment.
Wait,
again.
Is he calling me a hyper wife?
He's not calling me a hyper wife. Why would he call me a hyper wife? You're the hyper wife.
I had no idea. I had so much energy. So, I don't get it.
Well, I guess you do.
Okay.
That's okay. So, we try to make everyone happy here, and really, that's kind of what it boils down to. So, but yeah, we are going to kind of go through and shift some things around, like we were saying before. So,
Dirk just said you're about to go to Facebook jail and get zucked for saying BS. So,
yeah, probably that's entirely possible. And he brings up a good point. With everybody worried about data and everybody worried about advertiser friendly and everybody worried about, you know, family friendly and all that stuff, it seems like it could be bad.
It could.
And we are going to have a separate sort of podcast where we do a regular podcast, kind of like we did before for all the audio listeners, and some live stream because that'll be, you know, easy. But we're also going to have another one where we can say whatever we want. And anybody can say pretty much whatever they want, within reason, of course. So it's a simple rule, right?
Yeah.
Say or do whatever you want. As long as it doesn't bring shame to your family, then there you go. That's how I look at it. So.
Okay.
And Mr. Spooner says, as a former contest winner, I can assure you the stickers are on point.
Thank you.
Yeah. These aren't cheap, man. You stick them on stuff, they're on there.
Yeah.
And all vinyl and stuff, so yeah, they won't fade in the sun and all that jazz.
We actually went with a really good company, Sticker Mule. I love them. They are great. These stickers last forever. I actually have one from a hiking group, and that's how I got wind of Sticker Mule, and the sticker, it lasts forever. It was on the back of one of my windows, and it's the only one that hasn't faded yet.
Yeah.
So, yeah, love them.
Very nice. Yep. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. So, here's the deal. This is some pretty big news, but it's like breaking news.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Okay, so most of us out there use Gmail.
Yep.
Right, because, I mean, you have all sorts of mail to use, but, you know, if you've got a Google account, pretty much you're going to use Gmail for one thing or another. And they haven't really done a whole lot over the past couple of years.
Okay. Well.
No. Not really.
I think they have.
I think last time they made some real changes was like 4 years ago. Hmm. But what they're doing now is they're making a huge update.
Okay.
And it's going to make these big changes, right, to the email. And from what I was looking, I'm like, this is going to be kind of cool. Kind of like these. Right?
Yeah.
And email, you know, is they gave you the ability to kind of check email, kind of filter things away. It was really hard to delete things for a while. It's, there was never any need to delete. We'll just archive it, right?
Yeah.
But here's the big thing. It's like, you know, I don't want all that stuff all the time in my inbox. And Gmail, for lack of a better word, it's kind of wonky. No matter how you pick it, like a compact layout or the standard layout, it's still kind of wonky. You know, you have to put things off in folders to kind of get them. It's just, it could be better, right?
Okay.
But one of the things that they're going to do in 2018, this is going to be their biggest makeover that they've had so far, right? 1.4 billion users actually use Gmail. And these new tools and features are going to be pretty cool. But the one that I'm looking at is called Disappearing Messages.
Huh.
Yeah.
Okay.
So they made this announcement on Wednesday.
Yeah.
And if you have Gmail, you can go to the little cogwheel, which is like settings, on the top of the inbox, and you can choose Try New Gmail. And it doesn't look that different, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what happens is, right? What happened was, they've sort of set some things. They have a confidential mode, and you can have certain emails expire, like in a week or a month, and you can have things require a passcode. You can do, like, text messages and no text messages. And you can set expiration dates on messages that you want to keep.
This is already active for certain people.
Well, yeah, it's been around for, I mean, you know, well, Google, the Gmail is still in beta testing. It's been in beta testing since like 2005.
But I'm saying, like, if you use Google for business and your business profile is filled out for a certain industry, this feature is already available.
Well, that's great, but it wasn't available if you don't use it for business or if you don't have a business profile. Mm. So it's new to everybody else, is what I'm trying to say. Jeez. Well, you got to fight me for this. You didn't have it.
I did, actually.
Nope. No.
Yep.
Nope.
Okay.
See?
If you buy your domain and your email.
Try the new Gmail. I'm clicking. Right?
Yeah.
It brings it up. It's like, super logo pops up, loading Gmail, kind of changes things. It brings you to the welcome screen. And you can kind of choose how you want it to look, and it gives like everything's like nice and more compact and easy to read. You have default comfortable compact view, you know?
Yeah.
And so if I do default view and look at it, it's like, wow, it looks so much better. It looks so much cleaner.
See,
I can snooze messages now.
I've worked for small businesses, and they build their domains and their email addresses out of Google Dashboard. Some of these features are available, but the one that I have not seen that I really like is the follow-up or nudge feature. So
yeah.
Yeah.
But they've also added
an
icon on the right-hand side for your calendar.
Yeah.
They've also added Google Keep. If you never used Google Keep, and you're looking for something to take a quick note, that kind of thing, maybe add a picture to it, have it pop to your calendar, maybe have it remind you, use Google Keep.
Okay.
It's fantastic. Works very well. It's better than Evernote in a lot of ways. So if you're looking for like a note-taking app, or if you have an idea, you know, because sometimes you're in there taking care of business or paying taxes is what I like to call it, like in the bathroom. And you come across this amazing idea, and you're like, man, I'm going to do that. And then you don't write it down, so it doesn't happen. We'll just use Google Keep to do that.
Okay.
And they've also done some things, too, along with this new Gmail update, which not everybody has, but I guess people are getting it, is they've changed tasks. Because tasks was kind of useless for a long time. But now they have a Google app. Well, they have actually Android and iOS app for tasks. It's just a lot more useful, so you can actually kind of use it.
I am not looking forward to that one.
It's actually still pretty simple. I think, honestly, instead of using Task, you should use Google Keep.
True.
Yeah, because you can color code it. You can pin stuff to the top. You can add pictures. You can grab snippets from, you know, places here and there. So
this is pretty much empowering everyone to be like a small business all the time.
Yeah. Well, and if you click on the right-hand side, if you click a plus, then you have all the Google Suite Marketplace apps you can pick from, too.
Huh. I just like the nudge feature because I do have to use Google at work.
Yeah.
And I'll send out initial inquiries to people, and it'll be 3-4 days. And if the person's name isn't like in my memory currently, I'll forget to follow up with them. And then 2 months down the road, I get an email. Sorry, I missed this. You know, I'm really, you know. So the nudge feature I really like. It is very hard in certain industries to follow up with people. And then just, you know, as a YouTuber and a Facebook personality, you need to follow up with people.
A Facetuber.
Facetubers, yeah. But, okay, so new Gmail. Cool.
What? It's kind of a big deal, man. You're like, blah, 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 blah.
Well, I mean, 1.4 billion?
Billion with a B.
Jeez, all right. That is a lot of people. I wonder how they figured that out.
Well, they probably have like a list. Somebody's got a spreadsheet somewhere.
Well, I mean, because, you know,
they can look at all the active users.
I'm one person, but I've got 7 email addresses.
So I've been asked what's on my shirt. Can you seize it?
It is.
It's a buffalo.
It's a buffalo's.
It's a great white buffalo's. And it says Rome.
Rome. It says Rome, not rum.
That's what I said, Rome. What's wrong with you? I smell pretty good, though. Very nice.
You're crazy.
So it is a buffalo on my shirt.
All right.
Because Katie has joined us.
Hi. So
I can't believe you're not nearly as excited about this new Google update as I am. I thought it was fantastic.
I mean,
because here's the deal.
Yeah.
Why would you want to use anything else, honestly? Because, I mean, with the Google suite of tools and all the apps that they provide and all that stuff, I mean, it works. It works great. Like,
I think,
you know, why use Outlook and all that other crap?
I'm surprised that they made this announcement instead of just quietly rolling it out.
According to you, they already did.
Well, they've rolled out parts of it already, especially if you're if you have Google Admin Dashboard, which is a tool I have to use.
Yeah.
I've already seen parts of this when I have to issue out new email accounts for people. So It's great, but I only see it when I'm in Google Admin Dashboard. When I'm using my personal Gmail account, I don't have all these features.
Well, yeah, that's true.
Yeah. So if this is rolling out to everybody on a consumer level, that is pretty cool. I think the timing and the fact that they actually made the announcement is interesting because typically they'll roll these out quietly or passively, like not a lot of hype.
Right.
But the announcement that, I guess, AOL is shutting down all their email, like, soon.
What?
Yeah.
No more AOL?
I know, right?
You've got mail.
That's what
he said, really. You've got mail.
I'm trying to remember when they're going to shut it down.
Like that.
Yeah.
Very nice.
They made that announcement, like, I think last week.
But I really like the way it actually integrated Google Keep. It's a fantastic little note.
Oh, so they
note thingy.
Yeah. So,
like, for example, I made a note. Do you want to hear what it is? So I wouldn't forget.
Yeah.
And it says vaping. New terms for vaping, uh-huh. As in the, like, the little things you use.
Yes.
The first one is douche flute.
Okay.
Which I thought was fantastic. And the other one is robot penis.
Oh, God. No.
That's what it is. That's funny. Somebody else told me that. I was like, what?
So the fact is, yes. 1.4 billion people use Gmail.
Yes.
AOL is shutting down their servers, I think, within the next month or two. They made the announcement in December, but now they're actually shutting them down within the next month or
so. December when, last year?
December 10th, they announced that they were shutting down their emails. I know another email client is actually going away soon, too.
Who? So, Yahoo?
I don't remember. I'm trying to look it up. But, yeah, these old staples from the early 90s are finally, you know, shutting down. And now Google's out here officially making announcements when they really have no need to compete or advertise their services. It's Gmail. Everybody has a Gmail account.
Yeah. I like Gmail for business, you know?
Yeah.
Gmail for business. And my shirt is snazzy.
Yes.
My hyper wife bought it for me.
Would you stop?
No, that's not how it works. No. You can't do the squid. It's gross. So.
Yeah. David Leary's like, I thought they already did months ago. No, apparently certain people still have active AOL accounts. I know because I was talking to somebody and she mentioned that her dad's is still open.
Wow.
So they made the announcement in December and I guess they're completely phasing out everything within the next month. And that was actually on, like, MSN News. I read that, like, last week.
Really?
Yeah. So. Yeah. Oh, wow. What are you doing?
Nothing.
Uh-huh. So, yes. Moving on from technology.
We're not done with technology.
I am.
Nope. Remember the old AOL discs?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What are you doing?
I'm answering a freaking chat message, woman. What are you worried about what I'm doing? You're on camera. Worry about what you're doing.
Well, I'm just sitting here, and I'm done talking about Gmail.
Well, keep talking.
About?
There's a whole list.
Well, yes. So moving on from Gmail, the National Park Service is actually boosting their spending and budget in New Mexico.
Yeah.
Which I think is really interesting news, considering everybody was worried about a year ago that...
Well, actually, they're not boosting anything. Because what it reads is...
Yeah.
National parks boost spending in New Mexico.
Yeah.
So I put this in here. They're not giving New Mexico any more money.
No. Just the national parks.
Not even the national parks. They're not doing anything. What this report says, and the reason why I put this in here, I thought it was actually pretty interesting, because national parks here in New Mexico are good. I mean, there's like 15 of them that are amazing to go to, and they're totally worth going to. And when the children's came out, we went to a couple.
Yeah.
We didn't have time to go to a bunch of them. We only went to a couple. But, I mean, they're worth going to, worth looking at, worth experiencing, right?
Yeah.
Primarily because of the splendor. But what this report says, right, that more than, and this is a new report, and this is dated today from local news, a new report says that more than 2 million people who visited New Mexico's national parks, monuments, and wilderness preserves in 2017 spent $116 million in the state.
Okay.
When that came from the National Park Service, they released that report on Thursday. And it's, you know, part of the National Parks and the U.S. Geological Survey who actually conducted that analysis.
Yeah.
Nationwide. All right. So this is all the parks. 330 million people have visited those towns within the 60 miles from those parks. From a park, right?
Yeah.
And spent roughly $18.2 billion with a B dollars, helping to support hundreds of thousands of jobs.
Wow. Okay.
So that's why I kind of put this in here, because, you know, if you haven't been to a national park in a while and you show up, it may seem like, you know, who would go there? Why would they go there? You know, what's the point, right? And Wi-Fi sucks, because we've seen those where people are like rated on Yelp. You know, Yosemite sucks because the Wi-Fi is terrible.
Yeah.
But I was actually surprised at how much money that these things, you know, actually generate. You know, and they do support local business, and the towns get all the monies and stuff like that. But New Mexico has some of the best known national park sites, like, you know, Carlsbad Caverns.
See, I read the title totally wrong.
I know. Bandelier, White Sands. There's a bunch of them. It's like 15 total.
Yeah. My thing is...
But that's a lot of money.
It is. And it helps with the economy. And the one thing about New Mexico is New Mexico, most people outside of New Mexico, like East Coasters, they want to come and visit for the natural splendor, the beautiful outdoor recreation stuff.
Yeah.
A lot of the city and metropolitan type stuff, like Albuquerque Beer Festival or something, it does not bring in those numbers. It can't hold a candle to, you know, billions of dollars. And despite that, despite knowing that New Mexico, its crown jewel is its scenery and its lands, why aren't people putting money into those nearby towns?
Yeah.
I mean, the El Mapeas, which is one of my favorite areas in New Mexico. It's in western New Mexico.
Yeah, it's one of the places where the
it has
the children's.
Yeah, it has a tiny, tiny town called Grants, New Mexico, supporting it. And then a tiny village called Rama is your next closest thing. And there's no infrastructure there. Literally, you can drive through Grants in like 3 minutes. I don't even think they have a Best Buy, you know?
It's a little bigger than that.
Well,
I mean, come on.
Yeah, but it is still a very small town, and there's like two hotel options. I would like to see more money being put into those towns to support the tourism industry.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind
of... Well, I'm kind of going the other way with, excuse me, all the way around. If New Mexico makes $116 million off their parks,
yeah,
why are they not putting some of that money back in those parks?
That is true. Well,
you know, I mean, because right next to a lot of the, you know, the national parks, they have like local parks and all that stuff. They need to put some more money back into those. Like, actually, like, have somebody come around and like,
well, so
empty trash.
National park money gets put back into the federal.
Well, I get it. They can hire a federal employee.
I know.
They just need to put more money in it.
They don't, though.
I know. That was the point I was going to make for this whole thing. And Brian says that the drink you have on your desk looks like it needs ice.
This one?
Well, you only have the one.
Well,
it's a smoothie.
So the camera is blowing out the color of this. This is a smoothie from my brand new blender. It's one of those blenders where it's just the cup. And it's a very berry and kale smoothie, and it's
what? Gross.
I know. I had to put a little coconut in it to make
some beets. Does that beets in it?
Tolerable. Like no beets. That's the other one. So
that's gross.
But yeah, beets. It started to melt because I'm only so on it. Plus, I accidentally put too much banana in it. So
beets.
Yeah, I know. We should eat more beets.
No, I don't want to eat any more beets. Those things are. I don't like beets.
They're
beets
good
are awful.
For you. They're very.
Yeah,
good
the best way you can eat kale is.
Throw it in the trash.
You know, slather some coconut oil in the pan. You throw it in there and swirl it and slide it right off in the trash. Beets.
Yeah.
Very nice.
So, wow. I can't believe... I wonder how much money New Mexico state parks bring in.
Well, that's the thing. I don't know. But they definitely don't make as much money as what Amazon Prime is going to make.
Really?
Yeah. Okay, so if you are a member of Amazon Prime, you haven't seen a rate increase in 4 years, but you're gonna.
Really? I thought they raised
the price
rates.
Of no. Okay. Amazon is raising the cost of Prime.
Oh no.
Yeah.
That's not cool.
Okay, so Jeff Bezos, he revealed that there are 100 million Prime subscribers.
Okay. Right?
They all pay $99. Well, I can't say all. Just say most of them pay $99 because they have, like, you know, Prime for students and, I don't know, old people or whatever. Right? So that's quite a bit.
Yeah.
Now it's going to go up. So Prime is going to go up, I think, 20% or $20. So what is it? Going to be like $129, $119?
Yeah, $119.
$20 hike. So on May 11th, for new subscribers, the price rate hike is going to be $20 more. That makes it $119 for Amazon Prime.
I'm just a little speechless. That's a lot of money.
And the price increase is being made because of both the value of Prime and the cost to offer it have increased significantly.
No, it hasn't.
Well, I mean, not to me. It's like, you know,
because
what I've noticed for the rate increase and how they're justifying is like, well, hold on a second. I used to get stuff in 2 days, which is one of the big 80% of the reason why we actually even have it.
Yeah.
And then they changed it and says, well, not everything's going to be there in 2 days. So it'll say like Amazon Prime and you click it and it'll be like 3 to 4 days, right?
Yeah.
Or even worse, and if you have Prime, you can relate to this. They take the product that says Prime and you're like, yeah, and you buy it and it says shipped. And then they hand it over to the United States Postal Service and you don't get it in 2 days. You get like 4 days. Sometimes you don't get it at all, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm like, okay, so for the price, you know, here's what I'm getting. Originally, all I wanted was tax-free, right?
Yes.
And two-day shipping. And I know they have other stuff like Prime Video, Prime Music, and all this other stuff. But now it seems like it takes longer for stuff to get here. I got to pay taxes because Amazon has to pay taxes. So if it ships from Amazon, you got to pay taxes.
Mm-hmm.
And then they'll hand half of it off to the post office.
Yeah.
And you may or may not get it. So why do I even want to continue using Amazon Prime? Actually, Walmart is secretly doing the same thing. And I was thinking about this the other day.
Yeah.
Walmart has just the same sort of capability to do this as Amazon Prime does. They have distribution centers everywhere.
Yep.
They have stores everywhere. They'll pull stuff out of their store and deliver it to you. And I think it's like there's no cost. If you spend over $49, it's free.
Actually, in certain instances, like right now or last week, I should say.
And you can get same day delivery.
If I did $35 or more, just $35, it was free shipping. Hmm. It was free 3 day shipping.
See?
Yeah. And then if I spent $49, I could have it like delivered in a day or two or something like that.
And they used to have this membership thing where if you spent $49, it was free shipping. Free 2 day shipping no matter what it was.
Wow. So,
and I didn't do it. I probably should have. You know? But a lot of people think that the only thing that you can buy off Amazon is, I mean, I'm sorry, buy stuff off Walmart. Like, it's just Walmart stuff. And that's not true. You can, they have other shops and other, you know, it's not just Walmart stuff, too.
Yeah.
A lot of the same places you'd buy stuff for Amazon, you can turn around and buy it from Walmart as well. Of course, the problem with Walmart is also charges tax.
Yeah. Because they have a facility in every state, right. Blah, blah, blah.
You know, and sometimes you can save some money. I mean, if you look at it, as long as it's not fulfilled by Amazon and fulfilled by somewhere else, then you're not going to pay tax.
Hmm.
So sometimes that makes a difference. Because when I go shopping now, depending on how much it costs, usually if it's over $20, I go to Amazon and I also check Walmart.
True.
So,
you know how you were you were mentioning how...
No, I was complaining.
Allegedly.
Allegedly.
How... Amazon is now handing off packages to, you know, the U.S. Postal Service.
Yeah.
Originally, and I actually had to write Amazon support for this several times because we would have packages that were, you know, within the first day of processing, they changed from free 2 day shipping to it'll get there when it'll get there. And it turns out we lived in a rural area.
Yeah.
So.
Well, they just classified it as a rural area.
So, and that gave them the right to give their services to the U.S. Postal Service. Now, that costs money. It costs less money than it does to do it UPS. So how much money did they just take from an Amazon Prime member? And their excuse was, well, let me extend your membership by a month. Oh, well, thanks.
That's the way to do it. You need to extend my membership by 3 months.
Yeah. And that's changed. And now, like, I have a friend who lives in downtown Albuquerque, and his stuff is getting passed off to the Postal Service, too.
Yeah. In a lot of ways, I think Amazon's going downhill or has gone downhill.
Well,
And then, you know, they have the stuff too where they'll deliver it and they'll unlock your door and throw it in your house.
Oh, heck no.
Yeah.
No.
Well, they have one even now. It's a little bit different than they're trying right now where they'll do it to your car. Like, they'll unlock your car and put it in your car.
No.
Yeah.
I will not.
Like, no cameras. It's like, I really don't want it that much for you to come cruising around my house. I don't care if there's a camera there or not. And I get it. And actually, if you look up, like, package theft, it's huge.
Yeah.
I mean, it's, like, even more of a thing just outside. You know, like, oh, at Christmas time, always the news does a thing. Like, local news will be like, you know, they're stealing packages. But it happens all the time. It's an all-year-round thing. It's not just, you know, Christmas time.
Here in New Mexico, it was in the news recently because some of the people that last year were robbing, like, the neighborhood mailboxes.
Yeah.
They finally got arrested. Let's see, it started last year around tax time, but they didn't get arrested till like August or September. They're just now getting their court appearances. Half of them are on bail. And funny, mailboxes started getting broken into again.
Yeah.
It turns out somebody I know, her neighborhood was actually one of those neighborhoods where two of the mailboxes got destroyed and nobody could have their mail for like a week. Because they ripped them garbage. Open. And, I mean, I work in downtown Albuquerque. There's already a high crime thing. I tried to have lunch outside the other day, and I had to go back in because I can deal with one car alarm. I can't deal with five, so.
Man, people still got car alarms?
Yes. Really loud ones, too.
So, excuse me. Sandman. We have a request.
Really?
Yeah. Maybe it's a challenge. I don't know.
Okay.
In a comment, I can't find it now. Where to go?
Is it from Mr. Brian?
Yeah. Wants to talk about North Korea denuclearization.
Yes.
Yeah.
What am I supposed to talk about?
I don't know.
About?
He said, let's discuss. So here's what I want to know about that. Okay. They were really sort of not willing to negotiate whatsoever with this whole thing, right?
Yeah.
See, North Korea has a history of doing this. They make a bunch of noise, right? Mm-hmm. Rattle the saber for a while. You know, they would receive money, like lots of money, and our country is really guilty of doing this. And then eventually they would go quiet again, and life was great.
Yeah.
Well, this time, when it's with Trump, they have received no money.
Oh.
And he's been rattling the saber right back to him, say, you know, you want some of this? And, you know, they were shooting missiles and doing all this stuff. And it seems like the tide has turned and they don't need to make nuclear weapons anymore because they're like, what they said was, is that we already have the missiles we need, so we're good. We don't need to make any more.
Yeah.
Right? Well, that's the latest. And then the latest, that's about the nuclear thing. Well, North Korean leader Kim Jong, what's his face, met South Korean leader Samsung, I don't know, right? And they crossed the line, North Korea, South Korea come together. They're going to end their war, you know, they're going to be friends now. It's going to be great.
Okay.
And which is good. I'm like, oh, that's pretty cool. And so some people were saying that, you know, because Trump was pretty hardcore on all this stuff, that this is sort of a means to an end, and this is what brought this all about.
Yeah.
But I don't necessarily think that's the case because there's been photos of where they had their nuclear test site, and it's like a giant, still collapsing sinkhole.
Oh, gosh.
Kind of like where you blow a nuclear weapon up.
Yeah.
And the ground just keeps collapsing because you got a little bit of an issue going on. So my thought is this for real or not? I don't know. Right? Because there's some caveats to this kind of thing as to, is this a real sort of, you know, hey, let's have some detente and end the war and do all that? Or is it more than that? Is it like, well, we see, because they seem to act like their missiles are the best and all this stuff. And we know that's not the case. They're just wildly shoot these things off to try to, you know.
it's terrible. Like, you know, they threaten us again, and well, you know, they've been bomb Australia or something.
Well, that's the part of the thing too. It's like they shoot them off, and it's kind of like, you know, they may fly straight, but where are they going? I don't think that they really know quite so much where these things are going. I don't really think that they are as advanced as they think they are, or say they are, or want to portray that they actually are.
And it's funny.
I bet you're going to find that giant sinkhole is like its own little Fukushima.
Oh no. Okay.
So they're like, oh, hey, let's be friends. We don't need nuclear weapons. We already got what we need. We're gonna basically denuclearize everything. It's going to be great. Well, yeah, if your entire country's imploding on itself because you've got a nuclear sinkhole, you might need some help.
That's pretty scary.
Yeah. No more war. Complete denuclearization except for this big hole.
And it's interesting that you bring up, you know, this position on it and this, you know, this assumption, because other people who you wouldn't think are actually sharing a similar opinion, like, believe it or not, an op-ed in the New York Times, who thought, what? You know, and this guy's all like North Korea's phony peace ploy.
Well, it's good for them right now, because yeah. what are they going to do? They don't. They've already been sanctions put in place.
Yeah.
They don't have any money. Right. So what are they going to risk by coming to the table saying, hey, let's end war and denuclearize?
Yeah.
It brings them to the table to be good guys so they can keep getting money.
And
they need money.
This guy's showing some propaganda, like a North Korean and South Korean holding or shaking hands, and it's got the continent or the whole country unified. Yeah. But this guy who wrote this op-ed piece, he's basically calling this a whole P.T. Barnum style, a sucker born every minute
yep.
diplomacy tactic.
Well, they've done this a couple different times.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't trust.
Then you got like countries like Japan are kind of worried about like what Trump's going to say when he goes and talks to King Jong.
Yeah.
Is it Un? Yeah. So I don't know. I mean, there was even rumors like that he couldn't even, like King Jong Un couldn't even get a plane to fly far enough to meet him, Trump.
Huh.
Like as in he doesn't have the aircraft necessary. I mean, they're not a super wealthy country. If you contrast North Korea on one side to South Korea is like, you know, very yeah. wealthy. Because, you know, Samsung, everything else, they're yeah. super capitalist, they're high tech. Everything is nice like you would expect it to be. And on the other side, you got good old communist North Korea where, I mean, you know.
Yeah.
It's kind of like communist Russia compared to the great capitalist West where everything was great and wonderful. And I've gone to Russia, too, where it's kind of like you could see the throwback of everything sort of industrialized. It just kind of reminded me that every building that you went to see in Russia was like a DMV. It was awful. And then here you got this kind of stuff, too, with North Korea and South Korea. And so they're worried about the summit. And you've got other countries that are kind of worried about what's going to happen with the summit between Trump and Kim Jong-un. And then you also kind of look at this deal. It's like, is this a bunch of glad-handing so that they can maybe get sanctions lifted so that North Korea can come back and get a little bit of monies?
Huh.
Because that's normally what shut them up was yeah. money, you know. And every president's done it, with the exception of Trump. Like, oh, yeah, give me a little bit of money here. You know, the Clintons did it a couple times. They'll throw you some money, and you got to be quiet for a while. You know, and here you go. And, you know, and they have a terrible human rights record. Because they're communists. They don't care what you say. You know, it's like, it's awful.
And that Dirk brings that up. He's like, I'd love to hear their state propaganda about how South Korea and the U.S. came groveling to their glorious leader asking for peace.
Yeah.
Yeah. I bet that's exactly how it reads. It's...
So I don't know. So that's kind of my opinion is I don't trust this guy. I think it's a means to an end. I think we're going to find out that they have a serious problem with their underground test site collapsing in on itself. And there was whisperings that a couple hundred people died at that base. It's actually a deep underground military base.
Oh, God.
And they've been testing their nuclear capability there, and the whole thing has imploded on itself.
That's not cool.
Yeah, so there's some sort of... some theories there that, hey, they got some serious issues.
Okay.
So, I don't know. And I wonder if we can find a picture. Can we, like, put a picture in the chat?
We can. I just have to find it, or you can find
Look
it.
Look up North Korean sinkhole. Let me Google that real quick. North Korea lying.
Oh, there's sinkhole video?
Bastards.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, no. This is a... No, this is something that happened in a shopping district. Never mind.
Okay, well, if you Google North Korea nuclear test site collapse. And this is from... there's a bunch of places that are kind of kicking this around. Forbes is saying something, Gizmodo, which I guess you can trust probably about as much as Forbes. Gizmodo says North Korea's nuclear test site has caved in because geologists suspect that. And then Forbes says this could be the real reason why North Korea stopped its nuclear missile tests, because basically they have their own problems.
Up to 200 killed in North Korean nuclear test site collapse.
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, they're saying it's a tunnel collapse in this news report.
Either way, the nuclear bomb was detonated about 2,300 feet below the mountain's peak, causing aftershock earthquakes and the collapse of the mountain.
Ooh.
Which kind of goes back to, if you don't know how much of a big boom you're going to make, maybe you shouldn't do it under a mountain where a mountain can come down on you, right? It's the same thing when they go whipping those missiles off and they're like, aha, and they're flying over Japan and stuff.
Thanks, Ryan. So, he's like, this is a hot topic. Your viewership just went up by one, FBI.
That's right. It's like, oh, yeah, FBI's got, yeah, they're helping us. Well, here's a secret link to, you know, whatever, right?
Yeah.
I wouldn't click it.
No.
Yeah, there's ongoing concern that the collapse ejected radioactive dust, which could make its way to China and other neighboring countries. Excuse me. And the first four underground nuclear tests last year did not produce visible structural damage to the mountain as detected through satellite imagery. However, the fifth, and they say this is a 100 kiloton nuclear bomb, was detonated September 3rd, and it caused significant structural damage to the mountain. Yeah. So the bomb likely vaporized the surrounding rock and blew a hole in the side of the mountain, according to Wen Xiaoxiao, the lead geologist. I have no idea how to say anybody's name.
Would you stop?
It's like Li Zhang? I think it's Li Zhang. Li Jing?
I don't have the article up.
I don't know. Here we go. You ready?
Uh-huh. That
hey,
makes
man.
It better.
It's Chinese banjos. Maybe it'll help get me into I could say it better. It's like Wen Liezhang? Li Jing? Bang Chow? I don't know. Anyway, they said the United States Geological Survey reported a magnitude 6.3 earthquake followed by a second 4.6 magnitude earthquake shortly after coinciding with the detonation of the September nuclear test. You know what? I'm telling you, man. It says evidence of the collapse of Mount Mantop suggests that it could be the underlying cause of North Korea halting its nuclear test. Time will show whether the recluse country will develop a new nuclear test site or whether this marks the end of nuclear testing by North Korea. So, I don't know. What do you think?
I think that's enough.
Well, I mean, it's something I've been kind of following because this guy, they rattle the saber for a while. They get thrown some bucks and they quit.
Hmm.
Right? And then, you know, Trump didn't do that, and it became this big fight thing. Like, oh, no. Everybody's like, we're going to die. We're going to have World War III. And can you look at this being a victory for him? For him being more stubborn and possibly more stupid than Kim Jong-un?
No. Nobody can look at anything as a victory.
It's not.
Yeah.
But, I mean, you know, I don't know. And, you know, I just realized the one story I wanted to put in here that I forgot.
Yeah.
I need to find and put it in here.
Okay.
Yeah. It's about Uranus.
Oh, I shared that.
Yeah, but we didn't put it in here.
Okay.
Because guess what, everybody? Uranus smells like poop.
Smells like farts.
Which is close to poop.
Yes. Here, I'll share this one.
Shares it?
Yes.
Smells it. Smells it. He who smells it.
Okay. NASA finally knows what Uranus smells like, and it sure isn't flowers.
It smells like farts.
Yes. This is... While this might sound like the punchline to an immature joke, NASA and the Gemini Observatory finally confirmed that Uranus smells like rotten eggs earlier this week.
Farts.
Okay, they need to change the position of those words in that sentence, because that makes it worse. The smell, described by NASA as something that most people avoid, is due to the planet's cloud tops containing hydrogen sulfide, which is an odoriferous gas.
Yes.
The findings were presented by the U.S. Space Agency, Gemini Observatory, and in a study published in the Nature Astronomy Journal. So, yes.
Smells like farts.
Uranus smells like farts or sulfur or rotten eggs. So...
gross.
Yes. Huh. And now my thing is, NASA says it detected the hydrogen sulfide, the gas that gives rotten eggs.
He who smelt it.
Yes.
Dealt it.
So NASA says that it detected the hydrogen sulfide, the gas that gives rotten eggs their distinctive odor, using Gemini North Telescope on Hawaii's Mauna Kea. When I read that, I think of Futurama.
Yeah.
And Professor Farnsworth, he invented the smelloscope, where he could smell.
Gross.
Where he could smell different planets, and the joke was, Fry wanted to point it at Uranus, and yeah, so.
Should point at your own anus.
Which is funny because that goes into the whole Simpsons being able to predict the future as well as Futurama, since they're written by the same guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think his name is Matt Groening.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I thought that was interesting because I was like, wait, they detected its smell, and I instantly thought of Professor Farnsworth. So.
Professor Farnsworth.
Oh, I'm going to sneeze.
Speaking of sneeze, go for it. Achoo. Hold on, it's going to blow her nose and go. Nice. That's nice. Let me turn it up.
No.
There we go.
No.
Nice.
I can't even hear now.
Hello?
Yeah.
Talk, woman.
I am.
There you go.
Oh, all right.
So anyway, we're circling back to Amazon Prime. Do you still want it?
I don't.
You know, as much as I can sit here and go, Harry.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course we're going to keep it. We don't have much choice. We don't. I mean, think about it. What else are we going to do? When I think of Amazon.
We're going to shop local.
I'm not paying five. You know, here's the deal. I had this conversation too. I want to support local and do all that stuff, but I cannot. I have a percentage, right?
Yeah.
In my head. And if the price of something is 30 to 50% more, actually, it's just say anything above 40%. I got a problem with.
True.
Because, I mean, I get it. You're a local business, but I can't pay 40 to 50% more because I'm trying to support you. Because I got to worry about gas for the Great White Buffalo, which that thing is a gas-sucking pig.
Yeah.
Right? Time, effort, all of that stuff. You got to pay yourself because your time is money as well.
True.
By the time you factor all that in there, it's like it's not worth it to go and support. At what point does it cause an impact to me and how we need to survive by trying to support local?
Okay.
And we've seen it.
Yeah.
You know, like, for example, the cable I need to buy that I had to buy right here. You know how much that cable was at Walmart, which is not local, but it's just an example.
How much?
$25. You know how much it was on Amazon?
$6. $6. And I know how much it was at Best Buy.
Yeah.
Too. Yeah.
So, I mean, at what point, you know, I got to draw the line somewhere, man.
I know. And. A lot of people don't consider that like the whole, well, I need it right now type thing. But the problem is the I need it right now, the instant gratification, the instant getting the goods you need
yeah.
to do your job thing. The local market and retail market is failing those people as well. On Friday, I went to the mall. I never go to the mall. I hate the mall. But I had to go to the mall. And I got so fed up after wandering the mall, actually the mall and a strip mall, basically,
right,
for hours and just finding these name brand clothes of certain things that I needed to find that they were triple what they were on Amazon. And I'm talking like the brand name of X t-shirt or this button up shirt
yeah.
or this pair of shoes, a pair of dress shoes that I wanted. Some place wanted $140 for them, and right now they're on Amazon for $49.
Good Lord of the dance.
And I'm like, wait. Oh, and they didn't have my size. That was the other thing. So, you know, that's just clothing. And I can say the same thing about the special conditioner I use for my hair, certain things that we use around the house, products for the dogs. That, oh man. When
yeah.
certain supplements for Ben are like $40 and $60, you know, locally, but then I can get them online for $13 and it's the same exact brand.
Yeah.
I mean, and everybody's like, well, how do you know the online brand is actually that brand? I'm like, because Amazon vets them to an extent. That's how. So,
yeah.
Yeah. I'm not buying off Jimmy Bob's animalsupplements.com.
Not there's anything wrong with Jimmy Bob's animalsupplements.com. Just saying.
Yeah. But I think it's because Amazon's become such an integral part of our life.
Yeah.
As well as the fact that we have a certain lifestyle. We don't live in metropolitan areas. We don't like metropolitan areas to still get those modern needs and essential items.
Yeah.
We have Amazon. Yeah.
True.
Yeah.
So. Yeah. We have a certain lifestyle.
Well, it's true.
Lazy.
Lazy and lazy nerds. I mean, you know, you
lazy
have
nerds. How dare you?
You have a top of the line laptop. You have a relatively new iPad, brand new iPad.
Yeah, it's new.
Yeah.
We actually got, well, okay. I mean, that's the thing, too. Yeah. The laptop that I have, you know, I got it for $1,000, $999 or whatever.
Yeah.
Off Amazon. And the same thing is going for $1,200 on Amazon. And it's like $1,500 if you buy it at Best Buy.
Yeah.
You know, it just kind of...
And people are like, well, that's why you use Price Match. I'm like, Price Match only goes so far. And there's a lot of stores now who just can't compete with Amazon. So they're not accepting Price Match.
That's true.
And you have to fill out forms. You have to wait 6 weeks. I'm like, no, I'm not doing all that just to continue to support these other companies when they're going to make it so difficult. Every company has a bottom line retail price. And if they don't justify their metrics to meet that bottom line price as well as profit, then they're going to go under, like Sears and Kmart.
Yeah.
Yeah. So... I don't know.
Yeah, it's crazy. And then some people are like, well, I don't use Amazon Prime because I don't shop on Amazon that much. It's like, well, if you had Amazon Prime, you would.
Yeah.
So, I mean, because there's something convenient about, you know, if I don't need it for 2 days, I am more than happy to have somebody just throw it in a box in front of my house. You know what I mean? Because, I don't want to spend a lot of money. And it's convenient because there's been times where I've ordered stuff and shipped it, like, you know, I could buy it here and turn around and have it basically where, you know, the youngsters can pick up what they need.
Huh.
You know?
Yeah.
Like, my oldest needed to get a phone cable. Excuse me, a phone charging cable. And it was like $25 in the store or whatever. And it's like, I got a better one, a nice one. It was all braided and super kung fu for $6.
Yeah.
And so I was able to get the super fast wall charger. With the correct amperage, you know, because, I mean, anything that says 1.0 for an amp charger, like for your car or whatever, throw that thing away, man. USB charger, 1.0A on it,
yeah,
trash. I mean, come on, man. You have a wider selection, and if you can wait a couple days, it's worth it. So I bought it, boom. She had it, like, Monday.
Yeah.
Picked it up and was good to go.
Which is funny, because...
And they even sent me a picture. You know, it's like, hey, here's your package, and it's like, the package on the doorstep. And I know they're doing that to cover their own selves.
Yeah.
You know?
So the last time I was at the post office, I had to stand in line. I had to mail some things for work. And I'm standing in line, and I'm 4 people behind an older woman who is sending a care package to her granddaughter.
Yeah.
And due to the series of questions being asked by the postal service, the box, her care package, had to be opened, untaped, and every item had to be looked at because the postal service person... While the lithium ion battery rules are clearly plastered all over the place in a postal, you know, post office, having those rules doesn't mean that postal worker is going to understand them.
That's true.
You say digital camera, oh no, all hell breaks loose. And it takes me walking up and saying, hi, I'm a technician from a camera company, blah, blah, blah. You're putting this woman through a hassle just to speed up a line, you know? And I had to say it. Look, having worked as a technician, I understand how these things work. You're putting her through a hassle. It's in the original package. Why are you doing this to her? Well, I'm going to have to upcharge her $30 for a safety. No, you're not.
Right.
Because you know what? It just made me so mad.
It's like, excuse me, postal guy. How do you think that product actually made it to the store?
Yeah.
On a truck using the same rules that you put in place to actually ship something.
Yeah. And... You know, the fact that she had to go through that, she's a little old lady, and I'm like, you know, next time maybe you should just use Amazon, you know, or Walmart even.
Yeah, buy it online and have it shipped.
Yeah. You know? And it took an hour for that. Whereas, you know, if she had been on Amazon, she could have click, add to cart, send to her granddaughter at college, you know? Yeah. So instead of wasting an hour of my day.
No.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Huh. Oh, Brian pointed out, Wish.com has some cheap stuff if you can wait 3 weeks.
That is absolutely true.
Yes.
If you can wait like a month and a half. See, the thing about Wish is you can buy stuff and it takes so long to get to you, you forgot what you bought.
So it's like a little surprise.
You're like, what did I get? And you're like, what? That's great. And you're like, man, was I drinking when I bought this?
I actually want to start a little wish segment on this show, like where I talk about what I got this week.
Crap you got from Wish?
Yeah. I got a really cool t-shirt where it's got a pocket and you pull the pocket down a little bit and there's a cat giving you the middle finger. That's my favorite one that I've gotten so far. But then I get some junk. Like I'll order jewelry and it looks nothing like what it did in the picture.
Me too. Me too. Did you sneeze?
Yeah, I did. Bless I forgot. You. It was so impulsive. So, yeah.
Well, I mean, to everybody who's watching us or listening right now, we get these high winds in New Mexico, which is where we're actually currently broadcasting from live from New Mexico, unless you're listening to this like on a Tuesday and we're not live. But anyway, springtime brings in these crazy winds, and the way the wind blows through our backyard and the way our living room is facing is kind of faces kind of the backyard. Anyway, kind of a weird setup, but it works. Yeah. We had the door open, and it's like sand has just blown all in the house, which is okay, except for the fact that I just earlier today spent all that time vacuuming to try to get the sand, you know, because...
Well, it doesn't help if the vents that we have are blowing dust and everything, well, too.
Well, you know, and that's a weird thing. If you listen and you're on the East Coast where the humidity is high, you're probably not familiar with these things called swamp coolers.
Yeah.
Where you basically have to block it all off so you can use your heat, and then when you want to use the swamp cooler as a form of air conditioning, you have to come and open it all up and do all this crazy stuff, and it's getting close to be that time where it's like 80 degrees in the house.
Yeah.
So.
And you can't call it AC. You have to call it refrigerated air.
Yeah, that's if you actually have refrigerated air. Yeah. Know? Yeah. It's funny. It's like, do you have refrigerated air?
You fancy.
It's so, like, what? Yeah. No, we have central air conditioning. That's the same thing. It's refrigerated air. It's like, ooh. You gotta hold your pinky out when you say that. Yes, of course we have refrigerated air. We have a swamp cooler here, but the thing about that is, though, swamp cooler actually works here. If you get the ventilation right, it works amazing, and your power bill is nothing with a swamp cooler, so I'll take it.
Hmm.
Yeah. Coming from Virginia with them $300 power bills because the AC was on and still rocking like 65, 70 here in New Mexico. Sure, I'll take it.
Okay.
All day.
But, yeah, the humidity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, Chris, Mr. Hansen has joined.
Oh, hi.
Hello. I don't know why you're doing this. Hello. Yeah. But so, yeah, it's like it's a big difference with the power bill. But
are we should move on to weird news.
Actually, we're going to do a commercial. We're going to do a commercial, and we'll be right back. So you're listening to the Cheap Geek Podcast. So that's what we're going to do.
Okay. Audible is an audio entertainment that entertains, educates, and inspires. For you, the listeners of the Cheap Geek Podcast, Audible is offering a free audiobook download with a free 30-day trial to give you the opportunity to check out their service. To download your free audiobook today, go to audibletrial.com/CheapGeek. Again, that's audibletrial.com/CheapGeek for your free audiobook.
Yeah. I forgot to turn my thing back up there.
Great.
It's nice. Well, I realized that this little mixing board we have kind of set up here, I have everything for me farther away from me.
Yeah.
So it doesn't make sense. Like, I should put this one here so you could do your own things when you get a sneeze or whatever.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, it's just kind of the way it is. Very nice. So we're back, and thanks for tuning in to CheapGeek Podcast. If you've been listening and following along with us and doing all that wonderful stuff, we very much appreciate it. So if you're listening to the podcast and you do it through iTunes or Google Play Music or anywhere like that, if you have time, stop by and leave a review.
Yes.
Yeah. We accept only the finest quality 4-star, 5-star, 3-star reviews. Just saying.
We'll put a link to where you can review us on iTunes in the show notes. You can also give us a review here on Facebook. Those reviews, whether it's iTunes, Facebook, or even YouTube, help us become more visible to potential listeners and actually help the podcast grow.
That's true.
Yes.
Very nice.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
So we should... I know. I've been wanting to talk about weird news. I think it's weird because... you know, I've wanted to talk about this since the beginning of the episode. I think we should change our format a little bit.
Okay, first off.
Yeah.
How dare you?
Well, this is the weird stuff.
I like the weird stuff. The weird stuff comes after the, what we call the assorted BS phase.
Whereas listeners are dropping like flies, except for that just made a liar out of me. Hi, Anne Marie.
Oh, look what happened there.
So. Yeah. So, getting back to... with the weird news, Satanist adopted a highway, so you may as well start playing some AC/DC now. Hashtag puns. The devil didn't make them do it. They did it of their own free will. The Satanic Temple of Arizona has adopted a stretch of I-10 near Casa Grande and sent volunteers armed with pitchforks to pick up trash on the highway to... well, actually, it's to Phoenix or Tucson, depending on which direction you're driving. American Curl, a member of the group, told local Fox station KSAZ that she asked the State Department of Transportation if they could do the cleanup. I just want to clean up the highway. Please give me a highway to clean up. And they said, fine. So after filling out a form and paying a fee, then working like the devil to keep the road clean, the group now has an official sign, adopt a highway, the Satanic Temple of Arizona.
Very nice.
And they actually posted, I think, on their Instagram and their Facebook, the Satanic Temple Arizona chapter is now a proud sponsor on a small stretch of highway, and we have a sign to show for it.
Well, it's good to see productive members of Satanic Society out there doing something nice.
I think it's kind of cool. I mean, when you're driving in New Mexico, you do see a lot of these Adopt a Highway signs, and a lot of them have some religious overtones. Then a lot of them just make you go, what?
Yeah.
Especially, believe it or not, on the other side of the Sandia Mountains towards Edgewood and stuff like that, and even heading out further towards Tucumcari, there's like a biker gang that has adopted a stretch of road. One of the crazy artists up in Madrid that does like the little sculptures.
Yeah.
He's adopted a highway over there and it's one of the ones that's actually heading towards Santa Fe. So all the people of Madrid actually go out and help him clean it up.
That's nice.
So
I'm not a big trash picker up guy anymore. Unless it's court ordered. No, you know.
I think it's really cool because it's funny that people are like anticipating someone to freak out about it. So one of the members, he actually told this news website, his members don't actually believe in the devil. They simply don't believe in a God. So he had to clarify, which I think his clarification is just going to make
we
more people.
Don't believe in the devil, per se.
Yeah. I think his clarification is just going to make more people angry.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, and then to make things even better, they posted pictures of their cleanup on their website.
Really?
Yes.
Is it good?
Actually... with the exception of the Hot Topic boots in one photo. Oh, those are actually kind of nice.
Oh. See, that's how they get you.
Yeah.
Like, look, we're doing nice things. We're not devil worshippers.
It literally just looks like there's only two people here who look anything like Rob Zombie. Two.
That's it?
Yeah. And then everybody else, it's just, oh, excuse me, there's an eye patch. Okay. No, these people just look, they look just normal.
Hmm.
Yeah.
What are they supposed to look like?
Well, you know, I'm expecting, like, them to clean up in, like, their ceremonial robes and, like, with actual scythes and stuff like that. Yeah.
It's funny. They all look like they're court-ordered.
I know. That's true. Yeah, they do.
That's funny. They're like, hello, we're here to clean up your trash. Well, they have pitchforks. They don't need pitchforks for that.
Yeah.
So, well, some just use a stick with a pointy part on it.
Some of the trash is in, like, you know, some ditches, so I understand having to use a pitchfork. So, yeah. Huh.
Weird.
Well, I thought that was weird and interesting, and...
Well, that's very nice of them.
Very, very amusing. Huh. And this one, I didn't... this next article just bugs me.
Why?
It's funny, in a Facebook group earlier this week, I got into this big old discussion with people about how I don't like dolls. And this doll was very big in my childhood. It was kind of forced upon me.
Well, this doll was big in everybody's childhood.
I know, and I didn't like her.
It's still big.
But my parents kept
it's
buying her.
It's because she's
her.
A bitch, right?
It's because of her tiny, weird feet. I don't like that. Barbie.
Tiny weird feet.
Yes. It was announced this week that Barbie has had a surname for the last 60 years.
Yeah. So hold on. Before anybody guesses.
Yeah.
Or before we actually ask anybody to guess. Yeah. Actually, I just ruined it. Okay. So before we actually say what the name is, if you know, put it in the chat.
Yes.
And if you get it right in the chat window, we'll send you something.
Oh.
Yeah. Maybe a sticker or some random assorted stuff off my desk.
Yeah.
Or our desk. Yeah. Except for the smoothie cup. That's actually for the blender.
Yeah. And I don't know where to get replacements from.
Excuse me. So there you go. If you think you know what the surname is, go ahead and take a second and put it in the comments below.
Yes.
If you Google it, we'll know. So take all the time you need.
That's not true. So should we move on to the next article while we let people guess?
Nope.
Well, this
we're going to wait.
Awkward.
Yes.
Found out.
Who did? Nobody found out.
You know who found out.
Who? I don't know who.
Congratulations, Brian.
Good job Googling it. It's like I'm a professional Googler. Yeah. Well, very nice.
Yes. So,
like, I have no chat or anything. How do you know? Did yours update before mine?
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. So, congratulations, Brian. What did he win? Did you figure that part out?
No.
Well,
I think he's going to win a special rock.
Okay.
Of your choosing.
You are going to win a special rock. Yes.
Yes.
So.
And I will actually deliver said rock at a time that's convenient.
Yes, at a time and place, location unknown, but arranged prior to meeting.
Not to be disclosed. So if you guys are listening to the podcast, we do very much appreciate it. And also, we do new episodes weekly. So if you feel like you need to hear more of us, and you know you do, you should go ahead and subscribe wherever you're listening at. So there's that.
Okay.
You could be a winner here on the Cheap Geek Podcast. You just have to pay to play. And by pay, I mean, you know, just actually you don't pay anything at all. Just listen. So listening works.
So my thing about this article is Barbie was very influential in a lot of people's lives.
Well, sure.
And not mine, because I actually don't like dolls. They creep me out. My mom insisted on me having lots of dolls. And hated dolls. But everyone knows the word Barbie across the globe. People in other countries, people who don't speak English, they know what Barbie is. It's recognizable. And kind of like Cher, Seal, Prince, Madonna, and this article jokes, McLovin, none of these famous faces need any further introduction. It's instantly recognized, you know who they're talking about. Barbie, while not technically a person, has always been counted amongst those illustrious people for like 60 years now.
Yeah.
Unfortunately for her, however, her place in the one-name wonder roll call isn't in fact merited anymore. Apparently, she has had a surname all along, and that surname is Roberts.
What?
Her official name is Barbie Roberts. Which is funny because I don't remember that being mentioned in the Barbie documentary we watched.
It is kind of weird.
We actually watched a series of toy documentaries earlier this year on Netflix. And the Barbie one was really interesting. Kind of disturbing, too. But, yeah, we had no idea that Barbie's last name was Roberts. There was a tweet that went out, and it was Happy Siblings Day from the Roberts sisters. And it featured Barbie, Midge, Pidge, whoever, I don't know. It featured all of them, and nobody realized her last name was Roberts. As she also apparently has parents, and their name are George and Margaret.
What? That's crazy.
Here's the thing. Some mega fans may have already known this, but an overwhelming majority were like, what? And, Ken's surname is Carson, apparently. Immediately, Twitter freaked out. One of the biggest tweets was, I demand to see a birth certificate.
That's silly.
And other people are like, my life is a lie. But yeah. And then other people, when did she have three sisters? Now, I actually know she had one sister. I think her name was Midge. And then she had a cousin or something. But I had no idea. Oh, and Kelly. Yeah. Barbie had a sister named Christine who was...
What about Skipper? Wasn't Skipper like
Skipper, yeah. Hmm. So, yeah. But Christine was discontinued in 2001, and her sister Kelly was replaced with Chelsea in 2010. Apparently, Barbie's siblings get confusing and murky because a couple of them have quietly disappeared, like Skipper. Yeah. And now, her full name... Oh, her. Okay, now it all makes sense. Okay, her full name is Barbara Barbie Millicent Roberts.
Millicent.
And I think Millicent is a throwback to the original creators of Barbie. So, huh?
I got desert in my throat.
Yeah, that's just
Millicent.
Millicent, yes.
So, like, hello, Millicent.
Yeah.
What kind of stupid name is that? It's old school right there. That's what that is.
Yeah.
Well, Barbie's around, what, 40s?
No, she's like 60.
So wouldn't that be the 40s?
I don't
math.
Know. Yeah, what? Math.
Math.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, there you go. I just figured that nobody would know that.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Barbie Roberts. Like Barbie. Barbara Millicent. Yeah, that's nice.
You going to talk about the next article?
No. Maybe.
Okay.
Okay, so basically what it boils down to is I seen this and was like, this is crazy, right? Scientists have basically managed to keep pigs' brains alive for 36 hours.
Yeah. That's... I don't know.
Yep. It's just weird. U.S.-based researchers have successfully kept alive the brain cells of decapitated pigs for 36 hours.
Okay, why?
Sparking concerns over the ethics involved in such a frontline research.
I don't understand why you do it, though.
Well, I don't either. But it says that this person, Seston, had presented the findings of the experiments where his team restored the blood supply to the dead pigs' brains.
Right? Okay.
And they had seeded in, basically, since they delivered the oxygen to the cells via a system of pumps, you know?
Mm-hmm.
When the blood went in there and maintained the body temperature, they stayed alive. Okay. It says, thanks to this system, dubbed BrainX, which just sounds kind of lame, I guess.
Yeah.
Millions of cells were kept in good health and were capable of functioning normally.
Hmm.
However, there was nothing to indicate that these cells experienced some form of consciousness, saying he was convinced that they did not.
Hmm.
So this kind of goes back to, they were doing experiments for a while, like when they would decapitate people, like at the guillotine.
Yeah.
Like there was a guy, it was a doctor, I can't think of his name, but, you know, when he would yell at the heads and they would open their eyes back up, you know, and kind of like look at him. And then when they would close their eyes again, you know, because the heads are like in the baskets detached from the body, and usually they say, can you get your head cut off, you're dead, right?
Yeah.
And they keep doing it and they keep looking. So it's like, how long do you actually live?
Oh, God, I don't want to think about that.
Yeah, it's terrible, right? But here's something, too, though. What happens, you know, with this beginnings of this study right here, what happens when they, in the future, can take your head off and put it on something else?
You mean like in Futurama?
Yeah, like maybe put it in like a jar.
Oh.
You know what I mean? Pump some blood to it, and you can just kind of sit there and, yeah.
And then they can run for president in 2260.
Yeah.
That's so terrible.
It is terrible, but hey.
I don't like it. I mean, they're claiming that it's, you know, for the study of treatment of some cancers and debilitating diseases like Alzheimer's. And my thing is, Alzheimer's. I can't
Alzheimer's. Yeah, not Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's. All right. Anyways, the old people's.
Alzheimer.
With that, part of that has been linked to a lack of proper, you know, stuff being like blood and nutrients and oxygen being pumped to the brain.
That's true. This is the music I should have played.
Well,
you know, with the pig brains.
I mean, this is more creepy than spooky, though. So.
Well, isn't that creepy? I mean, you imagine if you walked into a room, there's like 36
pig,
you know, 36 hour old pig head just kind of staring at you, right?
Yeah.
You're like, oh my God. What is it? It's so scary.
I'd just walk out and leave. That's what I would do. So
I think you wouldn't. I think you'd be like, oh my gosh, what happened to you, little fella?
Let me open Instagram.
Yeah. But yeah, but wait. Let me take a selfie, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know.
No.
It's kind of creepy, though. You got to give it that. It's just a little bit.
That's, ugh.
Creepy.
This next article just creeps me out.
Yeah.
Because I can't.
This is, okay, before we do this next article, there's a simple question we have to ask.
What?
I thought you were going to read the question.
Oh. I'll do it. Okay.
So here's the question. See, but you have your little highlight over my highlight, and I can't see the question, so
okay.
Get it out of the way. How about that? How did you hijack my Google Doc?
Because I have okay, all so the Google the skills.
No, I don't think so.
Yep.
No. No. I'm going to go ahead and turn Omi off for a second. Okay, so which would you rather smell like? Fish forever or old ketchup? Forever. Yeah.
Ketchup.
This is that was it really wasn't your question.
Oh,
it must
okay.
have been for everybody else. Too, so. Just saying. You'd rather smell like old ketchup.
Yeah.
Over fish.
Yeah, definitely.
Huh.
I know without a doubt.
I don't know.
That's an easy call for me. Why? Because the fish smell only intensifies, whereas the old ketchup smell actually works with other things.
Like yes.
You could blend it, you know, you could blend it with, I don't know, pickles.
I don't think so.
And then you'd smell like a cheeseburger and
have
everybody loves
you. Have
you
ever smelled old ketchup? It's awful.
It's all right.
No. I'm talking about old ketchup, not like you just smell like a hamburger's a couple hours old. I'm talking like, you know, a couple days.
Actually, yes.
Because it was, you know, I did that with some copper pots. If you're looking for a tip. If you got copper pots, like copper bottom pots, and they get all kind of funky, you can put ketchup on there, slather it,
yeah,
slather it, and let it dry. And then when you rinse it off, it actually, the citric acid that's inside the tomato will help clean off your copper pot. But it, you know, it kind of smells. It's like awful. It's terrible.
You know, that reminded me of?
What?
That, like, our friend Rick should listen to this podcast.
Well, no, he already knows that kind of stuff.
Oh, okay. Yeah. But, no, I think I've smelled old ketchup before. Like, believe it or not, the Virginia Beach oceanfront smells like old condiments. So, yeah.
That's gross.
It does. So, I would definitely pick ketchup. Yes.
Okay.
Okay. So.
Well, this lady doesn't have much of a choice in what she smells like. She's a school teacher.
Yeah.
And she smells like fish.
Oh, poor lady.
So she has some kind of genetic condition.
Yeah.
Right? And here's where I try to pronounce it. Well, I don't know how to say that. So. Anyway, her name is Connie Christie. She's 43. She has trimethylaminuria, which is a genetic disorder which causes her to emit an odor that affects her breath, sweat, and urine.
Oh.
She's an Indiana teacher, mother of two. She takes probiotic digestion aids to help battle the rare condition that makes her smell like a fish.
Oh.
Yeah. And when she was growing up, she was lovingly called Connie the Tuna.
Oh, that's terrible.
It's pretty terrible, right?
Yeah.
So she said that eating certain foods, including fish and eggs, will cause her to reek to high heaven within 30 minutes because her body is unable to break them down.
What makes it worse is that Christy, she's unable to detect the odor herself, so she has to rely on her husband or two sons or even her friends to let her know. And that's just terrible. Kudos to this woman, though, that she is married and has two kids.
Yeah.
There, I saw a documentary where someone had this condition and they literally just lived in their apartment alone and never went out and never made friends. Like, all their friends were on the internet.
Yeah.
So, yeah. But she wants to reiterate that, you know, she is a very hygienic person and she knows it's not because of not being hygienic. She takes care of herself, but it's something that I can't control. It's always in the back of my mind. I'm wondering whether or not I smell. She showers daily, brushes her teeth, and uses perfume, but she's unable to hide the smell until she started taking probiotic tablets 3 years ago. Until then, she was leery about going on in social situations.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Terrible.
That's so... Oh, man, I feel bad for
her. Yeah, I read a book one time. I can't remember who the artist was, or who the writer was. I think it was maybe a Robert... I don't know. It may have been a Heinlein book.
Mm-hmm.
Where... What society did in the future for criminals was they didn't really do anything to them. What they did was they genetically altered them to stink. So whoever smelled them, it was like the worst. It was genetically tailored to towards whoever smelled them.
Yeah.
So they would actually stink to that person, and they would just, you know, of course, that person couldn't handle it, so they would avoid them.
Huh. Okay.
So their punishment... Instead of being like locked up and thrown in jail and that kind of thing, was that they stunk so bad that society just had a tendency to avoid them completely. So they had like no friends.
Yeah.
You know, no social interaction whatsoever. And since in the future everything was free, they were provided for.
Oh.
Because they had like these automated little food hut things.
Yeah.
But yeah, they were completely stripped of all sort of human interaction just based off the stink. And they even sort of illustrated it in that particular story where there was like... a place where you could go swimming.
Yeah.
And you could swim from like one large, huge water, like bubble to the next because the way they're floating around this like floating city.
Yeah.
Like floating in the air. And, you know, he was swimming around and people were having fun and all that sort of thing. But once they got out of the water, you know, and everybody could smell them, and they're like, you know, getting their kids and dragging them away and all this kind of stuff. Like, get away from this guy because it was obvious he was a criminal.
Huh.
So I don't remember exactly what he did. I remember thinking that would be absolutely terrible. You know, you're around everyone, but you just have no interaction.
That's kind of that's sad. Yeah,
it was kind of like Twilight Zone stuff, but I'm pretty sure it was Heinlein, although it may not have been Robert A. Heinlein. I used to read quite a bit in my younger days.
You know what makes me mad about this article?
No.
When you go down through it, you start to realize it's basically an advertisement.
Yeah.
And... You know, it mentions how probiotics have really helped her.
Yes.
And then they start busting out with the name of it. I'm surprised because when I looked up one of the probiotics, it's very affordable. It's like $15, which is funny because my stepmom uses a probiotic. And the last time I looked at that price tag on that thing, I was like, wow, like $38.
Ooh, that's a good deal. That's a bargain.
I know. So it's like, you know, if you're ever afraid of smelling bad, like this lady, use a probiotic.
It's like, hey, getting your stink on and you don't want to, take this.
Yeah. So I looked up both of them. One of them you can get for like $6. That's a good deal.
On Amazon?
No.
Oh, what?
Yeah.
What's so, that? Yeah, but I mean, I actually read this, and I actually thought about this story that I read a long time ago, and that's why I put this in here.
It's it's way more expensive on Amazon. Never mind.
Sometimes Amazon doesn't have good deals.
Yeah, $57.
Good Lord of the dance.
Wow. So if you do the math, this poor woman that smells bad, she's paying $3 a day not to smell bad.
Stinks.
Yeah. That's terrible. Which, you know, I pay $3 for deodorant in the last 30 days. So.
Well, that's good, right?
Yeah.
Very nice.
Huh. Okay. Oh. So, yes. You know, this is an offbeat news podcast where we do talk about...
Oh, wait, weird music. Hold on. Now do it.
This is an offbeat news podcast where we do like to talk about the paranormal. This isn't quite one of our paranormal episodes. I did want to mention this did get announced this week. The Haunted Queen Mary. It has now opened up its very haunted B340 room.
Yeah.
For guests, but it's going to cost you. So, sorry. The Queen Mary has been known to be a very haunted attraction. It's one of the few haunted boats in this world. And the stateroom B340, it's known to be the most haunted room on the entire ship.
Yes.
Now, if you don't know about the Queen Mary, it used to get talked about a whole lot on Coast to Coast AM. I think it's had its own shows. I do know that Ghost Hunters did an investigation there, as well as Destination Truth. I don't know if Ghost Adventures did, though, but at least two or three shows have investigated the place. It's creeped them out. Every time they put somebody in room B340, that person has been creeped out or ran out scared, stuff like that. Well, earlier this month, the ship opened up the room to be reserved by ghost chasers and enthusiasts.
Yes.
This room has technically been closed for 30 years. The only time it's been open is for, like, these investigative shows. They actually advertised it on YouTube. Now, you can click through the article. I'll actually give it here. You can rent this room yourself, even if you're not, like, a paranormal investigator person. However, the room is $100 more expensive than any other room on the ship.
So how much does that cost, though?
So, okay. I picked the downtime period for boats and cruises, which is in late September, October.
Boats and hoes.
Yeah, I know, right? And that was coming in at $300 for one night.
So that's just the room is $300, and if you want to have the special super haunted room, it's $100 more?
Yeah. Wait, no, sorry, backwards. So all the other rooms were in the $200 range, actually right. $140 to $200.
Really, that's it? To stay on the Queen Mary?
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, but then this room, it's like upwards of $305, I think.
Interesting.
But then you start adding travel taxes and all the booking fees and stuff, and it just skyrockets from there.
So is the Queen Mary an actual hotel?
I guess they opened it back up.
Because at one time it was just completely locked down. You could take a tour, but is it gone back to?
It's part of the.
Or is it just you could just stay there, but there's no amenities or what's the deal?
Queen's Attractions at Night and Haunted Encounters Tour.
Ooh, stay aboard.
Which is led by the ship's resident paranormal investigator. So you click on the link and then.
Well, it says they have modern amenities and world-class service.
Hotel attractions and events.
Nice.
I think it just stays there parked or, you know, docked.
That would be moored.
Docked or moored?
It'd be moored. You get moored at the dock.
Oh, and it's sponsored by Coca-Cola.
Really?
Yeah, down at the bottom.
Yeah, okay. So it was on Sci-Fi's, Ghost Hunters, Most Haunted, all that kind of stuff.
Oh.
But evidently this is like a for real, it looks like it's like a for real hotel now.
Yeah, and okay, I just found out the full information, whereas I went and looked at off-season rates.
Yeah.
Starting Friday, April 13th, so Friday the 13th of this year, so about a week ago, the starting rate for B340 will be $499 a night.
Good Lord of the Dance.
Yeah. So it is the most expensive of the three third-class staterooms that have been recently remodeled. As, oh, 10 Most Haunted Places on Earth by Time Magazine, Ghost Hunters, Most Haunted, and, yeah, I'm pretty sure it was on Destination Truth. So
where is this place?
California.
Oh, it's in Long Beach. Okay, that's right. So you get to go down by the docks where it's, like, not scenic at all.
Yeah.
And stay on the ship.
Huh. Oh, and on top of that,
they have specials and packages, too.
Yeah, I was trying to click on some of these. Hmm.
Oh, they give you a... Okay, so if you want to do, like, a package, if you were there in Long Beach,
mm-hmm.
you could basically stay on the ship, Queen Mary, and then they give you, like, two ferry tickets to go to Catalina Island.
Oh.
And they have a bed and breakfast package, 4th of July package. So it is like a tourist hotel type thing.
Hmm.
Very nice. And they have, like, dining and bars, Sunday champagne brunch. So evidently this thing is open.
Okay.
And doing business. So there you go. If you're in Long Beach and you want to go see something scary,
yeah,
go there.
Hmm.
It's very old. very, very old. Cool. It's it's nice.
Yeah.
So do you know where your mail is?
No, I do not.
Well, there's a lot of people that don't, and I know why. When you have things like this that happen, you start to wonder, right?
Yeah.
This guy. Officials say that postal worker hoarded over 17,000 pieces of mail.
Oh, my God.
That's a lot, right?
Yeah.
But don't worry, though. He delivered the important ones.
What in the world?
Yeah, so a postal worker who prosecutors say hoarded away more than 17,000 pieces of undelivered mail in New York City allegedly told investigators that he was overwhelmed by the amount of mail that he had delivered.
Oh, my God.
But his name was Aleski Jermash.
Yeah.
But he told them, hey, I made sure to deliver the important mail. So, you know what? If this guy is, like, hoarding all of the junk mail,
yeah,
he should get some kind of an award.
Yeah, but you know what? Even to hoard the junk mail, you'd still have to sort it.
Yeah.
And it's funny that this has been brought up. At one of my old jobs,
he had 10,000 pieces of mail in his car.
Yeah.
And then 6,000 pieces in his apartment, and then he had 1,000 pieces in his work locker.
Oh.
This guy had mail coming out of everywhere.
Yeah. So at my old job, I had a coworker, she really nice lady, and her husband finally got a job with the postal service. And I was like, oh, good. You know, and she's like, yeah, we're really lucky because, you know, he's actually replacing this guy who beat him out the last time. I'm like, oh.
Huh.
Well, what happened? She's like, yeah, he found the job too overwhelming and couldn't deliver all the mail. I'm like, what? And she's like, yeah, he got mad, so he just parked the truck, opened the doors, and walked away.
Yeah.
And I'm like, where was this?
Only the finest quality United States postal workers.
It was a full mail truck, like the big ones, not the little one that goes around the neighborhood.
Yeah.
And he just drove up towards Jimenez, opened the doors, and walked away.
Huh. Yeah. Did he get fired?
Yeah, and that's how her husband got the job.
Wow.
So, I don't understand why, you know, I had heard in the past it was hard to become a postal worker and, you know, emotional issues.
I heard
issues.
It was hard to get fired as a postal worker, yeah. But evidently this will do it.
Emotional issues, high stress, increase, you know, a lot of work to do. So it was hard to get hired. You'd think if it was that hard to hire them, there would be some screening. Like, are you going to walk away from a mail truck?
Well, I'm sure there is.
Are we going to find 10,000 pieces of mail in your car?
Yeah. That's a little nutty.
Yeah, so I don't know. I look at that and I'm like, I could do this. I could leave 17,000 pieces of mail undelivered.
Yeah, I don't know. I seen it. I was like, wow, man.
Yeah.
But this guy had it everywhere. In his car, he had 10,000 pieces, right?
Yeah.
In his house, he had 6,000 pieces. In his work locker, he had 1,000 pieces.
Oh.
He just had all this mail everywhere. No, but don't worry, I delivered the good one, the good stuff. That's kind of crazy.
Yeah.
Kind of funny. Not funny, but kind of funny. So, yeah. But you know, he got arrested because somebody had sent a tip. And the tip was that hey, there's a car with like 20 bags of mail in it.
Yeah.
So this guy just put it in his car and you could see it. He just didn't think that, you know, that people would notice bags of mail in his car or something. I don't know. It just seems kind of... Kind of sad. He was a little overwhelmed, I guess. So, well, he'll have lots of free time now. That's a federal offense, so who knows what's going to happen with that. Oh, probably not good things. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yes. Very nice. So we're getting to the point of the podcast where we either get done with it or there's one more thing to talk about. Yeah. I'll leave it up to you.
I don't know if we should talk about that one, only because I'm getting some conflicting reports about that one.
Yeah, there is. Maybe we'll just kind of keep that one for later.
Yeah. So do we want to talk about some binge-worthy stuff, though?
Sure.
Some binge-worthy BS?
Yes.
So, yes, we are still watching Brooklyn Nine-Nine. We actually decided to pick up on Big Bang Theory, which is interesting. I just didn't get into the show at the time it was really popular. I actually, when it first started, I didn't have cable. And this was before the greatness that is Netflix and Hulu.
Yes.
So I just never got into it.
Yeah, me either. I really paid no attention to it, so.
Yeah. And then, should we mention the movie we watched?
Okay.
We watched...
No.
Okay.
Well, I don't know what you're talking about. What movie?
We watched Demon House.
No.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
We should actually do an episode on that.
Why?
Because I think it'd be funny or interesting.
Okay.
Yeah. But we recommend you watch it. Yeah, and we should actually put a link to that in the show notes. So
yeah, make that happen. That sounds good. That's nice.
Oh, there what? We go.
Sweet. Link it.
Yeah, I'm trying. So here we go. And then let me put it here. So Demon House is a very interesting movie. It actually kind of scared me a bit. I think we should actually devote some time in the next podcast episode to discuss it. There are some very interesting points about whether or not this was a legitimate haunting and then the consequences of what happened in this house.
Yeah. Yeah. You can like make a note and send it to me in Google.
Keep.
In Gmail. You can use the Keep feature since Gmail was updated.
Yes.
Last Wednesday for most people. That'd be very nice.
All right. I will do that now.
So. Sweet.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Very nice.
Okay.
So we're about to wrap up the Cheap Geek podcast, and thank you very much for listening. This has been episode number 76.
Yeah.
66. Clean up the trash. Oh. I don't really have anything.
Look, suddenly... Hi, Quina. Hi, Seegers.
Oh, look. Why does it always happen? It's like, hey.
Yeah. I mean, we've been a bit live, and now they just showed up. Hi.
Like, hey, everybody, how's it going? It's like, what?
Hi, guys. So.
Very nice. Well, here's what we're going to do. We're going to go ahead and wrap up the podcast, but we're going to continue to live stream. So if you're watching right now on the podcast, hang around or stick around. If you're listening to the podcast, you'll be able to catch us again next week, and we do appreciate you taking the time to listen. And if you have a couple minutes, pop by and give us a little review. Like I said, we accept all the finest 3, 4, and 5-star reviews on iTunes and anywhere else that you may be listening to this podcast. Very much appreciated. So stick around. So let's go ahead and wrap it up, all right?
Okay.
Go for it.
So music in this episode has been provided by Incompetech.com, as well as Autonautics and Epidemic Sound.
Yeah.
All music is covered by the Creative Commons Attribution License 4.0 and 3.0. Music details will be provided in the show notes.
Yes.
If you want to reach out to us, you can do it on Facebook, you can call and leave us a message, or you can email us cheapgeek.net@gmail.com, and then the phone number again, 575-208-4025. So that's about it.
like peanut butter.
All right, everybody, thanks for listening to the Cheap Geek Podcast. We'll be back again next week. So if you have any questions, comments, concerns, like let us know. But thank you very much. This has been episode number 76, which was new Gmail, Barbie, Amazon Prime, and you smell like fish. So we'll see you.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye, sickle. We'll be right back.